More now on the major changes on the way for the Reserve Bank, the RBA, to become more accountable for their interest rate decisions.
John Keogh, economics editor of the Australian Financial Review, joins us now with more. Good morning, Johnny. Now, is this going to leave homeowners better or worse off?
Yeah, good morning, guys. Look, one of the more tangible changes that home borrowers, depositors will notice when these changes start to flow from next year is that the Reserve Bank will make decisions on interest rates every 6 weeks rather than monthly. So there'll be eight annual board meetings a year. And so it'll take a bit longer for homeowners and depositors to find out if interest rates are going to go up or down. I think overall it's not going to change the direction of interest rates a lot. Those 10 rate rises that we've seen probably would have still happened, even maybe faster, under the new structure that's being proposed that Treasurer Jim Chalmers has adopted. Overall, though, I think over time we'll probably get slightly better decision-making with more experts on the board, the press conferences from the governor, other RBA board members giving speeches and also being more accountable for their decisions too.
It's interesting. I'm loath to raise another commentator from an opposing paper, especially given you're the best and you have the best paper.
Obviously.
But Terry McCran raises the point this morning. He says the seductive, dangerous allure is to accept a little higher inflation to avoid higher jobless rates. That is the pathway to economic hell. Do you believe that?
I think that's largely true. I'm not sure that's what the review's pointing to, though. A lot of people have made a big deal about one of the dual mandates for the RBA being full employment and the other inflation, but that's always been the case since 1959. Now, they did appoint two former sort of union officials to the board yesterday, Jim Chalmers. So you could argue maybe there'll be a little bit more focus on employment over inflation. But overall, Philip Lowe said, look, our focus isn't going to change. The reviewers who we spoke to on background yesterday said it's not a big change either. So I think it's more at the margin rather than any sort of fundamental revolution.
Interesting.
Just quickly, John, do you think Philip Lowe will keep his job?
Sarah, the Treasurer yesterday said he'll make a decision mid-year. His seven-year term ends in September. I think it's probably unlikely he's going to get an extension, let's be honest. It's possible he gets a very short-term extension if they need to put a bridge in place to the new governor and new system. But he's had a 40-year career at the bank. The review says that their leadership needs to drive through these changes, and I'd probably expect a new governor to come in later this year.
I'm sure he'll miss it.
Well, I don't think he's going to miss the media scrutiny outside his house, that's for sure. He'll be playing more golf on the weekends, I reckon. Yeah.
Good on you, mate. Thank you. Have a great weekend.
Well, mortgage holders could soon say goodbye to monthly interest rate decisions, the Reserve Bank facing its biggest overhaul in decades. A scathing review has recommended the RBA should meet less and that our interest rates be decided by a board of experts. Let's bring in Deputy Prime Minister Richard Marles in Geelong and Opposition Leader Peter Dutton in Brisbane. Good morning to you, gents. Now, Richard, who are these experts we're putting in charge of our mortgages?
Well, we're wanting to make sure that the Reserve Bank is in the best possible decision, in the best possible position to make the really important decisions that it does. And Australians obviously are hanging off the decisions of the Reserve Bank every month, understandably. This review is a really important review to make sure that our central bank is operating in the best possible way. And one of those recommendations is to divide the board so that we have a more expert group which are considering those interest rate decisions and to have those decisions occurring on a slightly less frequent basis. But it's a really important review and we're looking at implementing it in full.
And you are hopeful that it will improve the situation for mortgage holders out there?
What it will do is make sure that the Reserve Bank is operating in the best possible way. I mean, obviously, a review of this kind doesn't change what the global inflation environment is or the challenges that we face with our economy, but it does mean that when the Reserve Bank is coming to meet to make the really important decisions that it has to make, that it's doing it with the best information, with the best experts in the seat, and obviously in the most independent way, and that is going to be a benefit to Australians.
So will it make any difference to interest rates?
Well, it will mean that we've got the best possible central bank making these decisions. So in that sense, yes. But I don't want to stand here and say to you that this review is suddenly going to change the global inflationary environment. I mean, obviously it's not. But it is going to make sure that we've got the best central bank in the world making the decisions in the context of that environment.
No, Philip Lowe made some promises and that didn't bode well for him, that's for sure. Now, Peter, the unions are pushing for a seat at the table, obviously with this expanded board being split in two. They haven't got one yet, but they're close to it. How would you feel about that?
Well, Sarah, look, a couple of points. I mean, we'll support the government in, you know, modernising institutions and making sure that they're fit for purpose. But, you know, to be honest, this is a bit of window dressing and a little bit of distraction. The fact is that the Reserve Bank doesn't set the inflation rate and they operate within the band. And it's going to be difficult to get back into that target band that they want inflation to be in. And if they don't, then interest rates will remain high. And part of the reason in our country is, you know, that inflation is high is because the government's made a number of decisions which have forced up inflation, and therefore that's fed into higher interest rates than you would otherwise be. And since Labor's been in government, interest rates have essentially gone up every month. So families are feeling that. The Labor Party wants you to believe at the moment that they've got some magical solution, but as you saw with that tiptoe dance from Richard there, he's not committing to this meaning lower interest rates for families.
But you do support them. I mean, it's difficult to kind of bag these changes if you are going to get on board.
Well, again, you've just got to deal with the facts. And the facts are that Labor's industrial relations system is going to make it harder for small business. If you have a look at what they're doing in energy policy, it's driving up the cost of gas and electricity, and businesses then pass that cost on to consumers in higher costs of food and groceries, etc. And that's what fuels inflation. And that's what makes your interest rates higher. And that's why interest rates are always higher under a Labor government.
Richard, obviously all of this is
making... Sarah, can I just make the point that that's just obviously wrong, what Peter said. I mean, we made decisions at the end of last year which have actually eased the pressure on energy bills. And when Peter was given an opportunity to support those decisions,
Richard,
he voted against them.
Honestly.
So, I mean, the one step that Peter's been able to take is to vote against this.
Last year? Really?
I mean, there is a global inflationary phenomenon which is going on, and interest rates started going up under you. That's what happened.
We were in South Australia earlier in the week. There was Safcol, who's the biggest producer of baby food in the country, and they do, you know, the stocks and everything else that you can buy in the supermarket. Huge company. Mm. Their electricity bill under this government just in January went up by 120%. Their gas price in the last 6 months or so has gone up by 340%. They have to pass that on to consumers or they go broke. So this nonsense that, people are paying less for electricity...
So why didn't you try and help in December?
I mean, this is the thing, the situation out there is...
You've made a bad situation worse, I tell you.
The situation is very difficult for so many out there. And I guess, Richard, one of the things that could help is increasing job seeker to those most vulnerable. Is that something that the government will consider? We know the budget's coming up.
Well, the report was released earlier in the week and it made suggestions in respect of this. Obviously, you know, we're not in a position to fund every good idea, and what you can be absolutely assured of is that this budget is going to be fiscally responsible and we will be totally focused on easing the cost of living pressures on Australian households and their household budgets. Equally, you know, you will see measures in the budget in the next few weeks which look to improve the situation for the most disadvantaged. Mm. But we're not in a position to fund every idea which is out there. I don't think the committee would have expected that to all occur in the context of one budget, and we will be having a fiscally responsible budget that we hand down in a few weeks' time.
Yeah, I mean, look, this is an idea that the Prime Minister, your leader, has been lobbying for. Basically, in 2020, we saw him tweet that there should be permanent increases to JobSeeker. I mean, has he changed his mind?
No, and we understand the pressures that are particularly faced by our most vulnerable. And as I've just said, you'll see measures in the budget which go to improving the situation for the most disadvantaged.
Yep.
But there are a lot of competing tensions in the budget, as there are in any budget. And what I can tell you is the budget is going to be fiscally responsible and it is going to be centrally focused on easing the cost of living pressures on Australian households.
Peter, could you live off $49 a day?
Well, no, and I think there's an important point to make here. People on low incomes in particular heard very clear messages from the Prime Minister before the election for instance, on 97 occasions that they would reduce your power bill by $275 a year, every year. It's never been mentioned since he was elected. And this is a government, I think now it's up to about 19 broken promises from before the election to after. So you can tell people what they want to believe and what they want to hear before the election, but the Prime Minister clearly is just breaking the promises. And if he didn't intend to fulfil this, then why make it in the first place? I think it's a, you know, it's a pretty tricky, deceive, you know, a devious way of treating people, particularly those that are most vulnerable.
All right, we have run out of time. I love how feisty you two are this morning. It's wonderful to see. Have a great weekend, guys. Thanks for your time.
Couldn't have them back together.
Welcome back. Well, if you're tired of hearing about rate hikes, skyrocketing bills and whispers of a recession, this could be the news you need to hear.
From cheaper Netflix to free Uber rides, there are reasons to smile about your finances this morning. Finance expert and author of Easy Money, Joel Gibson, joins us now. Joel, good morning.
Hey, Joel.
Energy prices. They're finally coming down.
They are finally coming down. The wholesale prices are coming down, and that's what eventually will hopefully lead to lower retail prices. But if you have a look at this graph, you can see how high they got in that spike last year. We're back to sort of around the time of the Russian invasion of Ukraine, which was the beginning of all the issues, of course, in the wholesale energy market. So that's really good news.
Good news for winter.
It is good news for winter. We're still going to see, unfortunately, that big 20% price hike in the government reference price. What we're now going to hope is that the retailers who set their plans off that price will start to, you know, have a little bit of leeway to make them
a
bit cheaper.
Will?
Well, they already are. Okay. There are some early signs, especially in Victoria, rates are getting lower.
Now, this is a staggering number. We lost 80% more to scams in 2022, but there's one type of scam that we're finally getting on top of.
I did. I looked long and hard in this report this week. It's one of the scariest reports I've read. I don't know about you guys. I'm getting a scam text or phone call every single day at the moment. There is one little bit of silver lining in that report this week, and that is that phone call scams went down by 56% last year. And the reason is because there's a new code that says that telcos must block, if they're reported a particular phone number that's giving scam calls, they must act to block it and police it. And so ScamWatch, the ACCC's ScamWatch group, they're sharing this information with telcos. They're working together. It's important if you get one of those scam phone calls, you report it because it will go around the system.
We had the NAB security expert on this a couple of weeks ago saying there are a couple hundred thousand a day.
Oh. Yeah,
you know,
crazy.
It's terrible. Netflix is likely to crack down on password sharing by June. How is that good news?
Okay. Well, because I think the people think they've found a loophole in this new Netflix pricing system. It's been rolled out so far just to Canada, New Zealand, Spain and Portugal. But they've said broad rollout by June, which means we can probably assume it's coming here very, very soon. The current system, if you've got two households with two Netflix subscriptions, it'll cost you about $34 a month if you're using the subscription that gives you two screens at once. Under the new system, the second house, if it's a family member or a friend or whatever, can be an add-on member to the main account. And so you can get that cost from $34 potentially down to $25. So what it's going to do is punish the people who are surfing for free on other people's accounts, but it might reward people who are currently doing the right thing, and there might be a cheaper way to get Netflix.
All right, we'll see how that goes.
Yeah, I don't know if I like it either. What about cheap ways to get around on the weekend?
Oh, there's a couple of good ones this month. So Uber recently bought Car Next Door, which is one of the big car share companies. There are now 8,000 odd cars that you can rent other people's cars via GoGet or Uber Car Share, for example. They've got a promo this month, $200 credit if you're a first-time user. Just put that code there, UCS134, in at the checkout. That'll last you for 2 months. If you're in Victoria, they've capped regional public transport fares. So you can go anywhere this weekend in Victoria for a maximum of $6.70 a day.
Well, later in the year, after the Melbourne Cup, you'll be able to get a lift home with the cops if you're drunk. I mean, it's just amazing. Progressive.
Freebie.
That's it. Thank you, mate.
Thanks.